and recordings may now commence. Okay, apologies. So far, we have apologies from Councillor James Roberts, also from the Chief Fire Officer. Are there any declarations of interest in relation to any item? No matters of urgency that I'm aware of. And there are no items of exempt information. So we move on now to the minutes of our previous meeting held on the 21st of July. We've only got two pages to look at. Are members happy to approve these as a true record? Our first agenda item, 3, which is the update from Greg Thornton. And is it?
It's me.
No,
do I need to?
We'll just quickly tell your name.
Oh, sorry, it's John. John Padfield.
John Padfield, thank you.
Do I need to press this button? This button? Yes, I'm here. I guess representing the fact that also the field manager, Paul Basnett, who's indisposed today. So I'm pleased to have the opportunity to come along. I'm very much involved with the detailed work in the audit. I think my contact details are on the first page of the report. I wasn't proposing to talk to the detail of the report particularly because you'll see that it suggests that we're very much at the beginning of our annual audit cycle, and the first sort of involvement from us that you might expect will be our interim visit, which is planned for the next month, February. So we'll be coming out to see you very shortly, and that will result in the introduction of the audit plan in April, which we'll look to agree with you. There are a couple of things I did want to point out there. In terms of deadlines currently, and for 15-16, and in fact 16-17 audits as well, officers are required to produce draft accounts for audit by the 30th of June. We're required to sign off the accounts and give our opinion on the accounts by the 30th of September. These deadlines have been in place for many, many years. But in a couple of years' time, they will be coming forward, and there'll be a requirement to produce draft accounts by the 31st of May, so that's a month earlier, and a requirement for us to give our audit opinion by the 31st of July, so that's 2 months earlier than presently. So what we're planning to do, by way, I suppose, of a bit of a dry run or working towards the meeting these tighter deadlines, is to see if we can give you an earlier audit opinion this year. And we're currently in discussion with Ian and his team about what we might be able to achieve and how we might be able to work together with them to achieve that. But whatever we do, certainly one feature of it will be our attempts, and we've always done this to a certain degree, but certainly our attempts to see what work which we might have previously carried out in the post-statements period between July and see if we see which elements of that we can actually accelerate and bring forward to our interim visit. So we'll be trying to do more of that work in February of this year. One example, and again, it's not to say that we haven't done this kind of thing before, it's just there'll be a kind of a greater focus on it. Might be if we are testing a transaction stream, perhaps payroll transactions across the whole year, we might take the opportunity to see if we can split the sample into two bits and look at 9 months worth of transactions in February and on top of the testing when we come in the post statements period. As I say, we've done this kind of thing before, but I think in order to meet these new deadlines in due course and make the whole process a little smoother, we'll be looking to see what kind of work we can actually bring forward in that way. We'll also see if we can give you an early, as well as the opinion on the accounts, we'll also see if we can give you an earlier value for money conclusion as well. We'll have to give a value for money conclusion again this year. Similar to last year, but the scope of it has been framed in a slightly different way for 15-16. And if you just have a look perhaps at page 5 of the report, you can see the overall scope here. Reduced to a single sentence there, without work requiring a conclusion on whether in all significant respects the audited body had proper arrangements to ensure it had properly informed positions and deployed resources to achieve planned and sustainable outcomes for taxpayers and local people. It feels like it's been quite an effort to actually distill that into one sort of quite long and complicated sentence. I don't think that's so different to the focus that we've previously had, but I think if I was to highlight any particular difference, it is that there will be, I think, a little bit more emphasis this year on the way you work with partners and third parties to in partnership to achieve your objectives. So in terms of what we're likely to be looking at, similar focus to previous years, but we'll certainly be looking at, and we're at a very sort of tender stage in our planning in that respect at the moment, but we'll certainly be looking at the way the authority continues to respond to the savings challenges which are presented by cuts in central funding, both in terms of back office services and the operational side of frontline services as well. But perhaps particularly, or with a little bit more emphasis, this year as well, the way in which the authority is collaborating with other agencies and other partners to achieve those objectives. That will come a little bit more into focus. And that's pretty much it, really. I think just to say that I think there is the, I'm slightly familiar with these things, but that there is obviously the usual information at the back of the report about the work that Grant Thornton has been doing nationally in the sector with some links to certain reports which might be of interest, and just to say you can follow those links, but if you did want additional information about any of that, then please just do get in touch, and you'll find on the front page of the report the contact details of myself and Paul Basner, the manager, and Mike Thomas, our engagement link. So that's it from me.
Yes. Does anybody have any questions for John?
Not questions, Chair, just some observations, really. I mean, interesting times ahead, excuse me, obviously, for fire and rescue authorities, and now we're under the auspices of the Home Office rather than DCLG, and whether that will bring us any benefits financially or otherwise, who knows yet, really. But again, only this week there was news items about fire and rescue authorities coming under the auspices of the Police and Crime Commissioner. And clearly, you know, we've got opposition here, and I don't think any of us from any parties have a huge appetite, to be fair, for that, and would like to see ourselves stay as a fire and rescue authority. I'm just wondering how all that uncertainty really would feed into how you look at things. Do you think there's, I mean, I'm asking to look in a crystal ball, I suppose, and see, do you think there will be an advantage for fire and rescue authorities as far as finance is concerned coming under the Home Office, or would we likely just suffer as much as we did at the moment?
It would be hard for me to say at this stage, I'm afraid. Certainly this whole landscape, and sort of winding back to the whole pressure that came up to collaborate in a variety of ways with the other emergency services is very much part of the landscape that we will be looking at now and we're supporting developing in conclusion. But as you said, I think it's probably very early days in most of those times, yeah.
Watch this space. No further questions or comments. Can we notice the board and thank you all for coming along? And please give Paul our best wishes for his recovery.
Ideally, it's not. No, he's. He also has some police audit clients. I think he's at a kind of a regional planning meeting today, so that's why he's not coming along. But I'll certainly pass on your best wishes, everyone.
Thank you. Swiftly moving on. On page 23 is the internal audit progress report, April to November. I think Ian's going to speak on this.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, and as per paragraph 6 and 7 on page 24, the authority buys it 112 audit days per annum for Liverpool City Council's internal audit department. At the start of this year, this committee signed off the 2015-16 internal audit plan, and today's progress report provides an update on the plan and expected progress for the remaining part of the year. This will then be followed up by a year-end report that will outline the actual performance against the plan. In addition, members will receive a copy of all the individual audit reports once they've been finalised. So that gives an update on sort of how you prepare the plan, progress report, and you'll receive an outstanding report at the year end. As per the table on paragraph 7, approximately 40% of the 112 days is spent on reviewing what we call fundamental systems, and they're outlined on page 28, paragraph 3.3. But as per the report on paragraph 10, the audit work on the fundamental systems is carried out at the end of the financial year to fit in with the Reliance external audit in place of the key financial systems as part of the audit of the statements of accounts that John's referred to before. Most of the remaining audit days are spent on specific project work. The table on page 24, paragraph 8, outlines the scheme projects that we've got planned for 2015-16. Most of the work, though, is going to be carried out between December and March, and this is to fit in with when these initiatives have progressed far enough that audit can go in and do some evaluation work. So although attached to the report, Appendix A, is the progress report we've got from Melanie Dexter, who's the senior auditor responsible for managing the authority's audit work, I think the reality is, rather than a progress report, you can see really as an update report that's basically indicating to members that most of the work is going to be carried out in the last quarter year. So there's a bit of contradiction in between the title of the report and what you're actually getting, I think. So really at this point in time, I'm just asking members to note the report. I'm happy to take any questions, but as I said, most of the work is going to be carried out in the last quarter, but I thought it was worthwhile bringing this report because you haven't seen anything, and to allay members' fears about what work hasn't been done so far this year. But I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions for Ian? Well, as Ian said, this is a report for noting. Are we happy to do that?
Good.
Thank you. Move on now to agenda item 5. Treasury Management Interim Report.
Yes, Chair, thanks for that. The relevant regulations and codes that govern Treasury Management require members to consider three reports throughout the year. The annual treasury management report, which as per paragraph 4 on page 32, covers the approved framework under which officers manage the treasury management strategy. And this was contained in the budget report that went to the authority meeting on the 26th of February. This is then going to be followed up by an interim report during the year to ensure treasury management activity are consistent with the strategy, and this is today's report. And then that will be followed up at the year end with an outturn report that confirms that activity in the year was consistent with the approved strategy. And that report will probably go to the audit subcommittee meeting in June 2016. Members also receive regular updates on treasury management performance throughout the year through the quarterly financial reviews as well. So attached to this report, Appendix A, is the treasury management activities update. And members will note that the so far the year, the activities have been consistent with the approved strategy, but some specific points I bring to members' attention. As expected, no new loans have been taken out so far in the year, or are likely to be taken out by the year end. Investments have been made in line with the investment strategy, which prioritises security and liquidity of funds over yield, which basically means we invest monies with high credit ratings rather than seek higher interest rates, which carry significant risk. Investment returns are above the benchmark, page 37, paragraph 15. As I say, members received an update on treasury management before Christmas in the financial review report, so I don't think there's anything really new in this report to what you've considered just before Christmas. Everything's on track, activities are consistent with the strategy, but I'm happy to take any questions if members have.
Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Just ask you to confirm in the paragraph 9 it talks about where we've got our money invested, mm-hmm. and under UK local authorities, do we actually use that facility or not? I know there's quite a lot of discussion within our own local authority about some of our investments being loaned on very low rates to other authorities, and obviously they're having the benefit of that, whereas...
Yeah, we haven't at the moment. In terms of our borrowing, we tend to go to the Public Works Loan Board. But at the moment, there's a discussion around the local government pension scheme and the investments that has, because it's a funded scheme, there's billions and billions of pounds held by the various local government pension schemes, administrators, Wirral, locally. And the government to try and encourage those local government pension schemes to pool resources and offer that up as an alternative to PWLB. But as I say, at the moment we're trying to avoid borrowing, use internal cash and keep interest down. But at the next opportunity we need to go out and borrow additional funds, we look at PWLB, we compare it to the local government pension board offer and any other sources of funds and get the best deal.
That's fine. I'd just be interested that if we do get in a position where we loan to the local authorities, that would be detailed and it would be broken down as to where the money was.
Yes, yes.
No further questions, we'll ask to note the report. And our final item, corporate risk register update, and Phil.
Yes, indeed, thanks, Chair. On the basis of this report, it's been informed that the current risks contained within the corporate risk register, the status of those risks and the associated control measures, and including any reference to new risks which have been added to the risk register during the period being from July to October 2015, and recommendation that members approve the updated risk register. As I say, members will be familiar with the process and the documentation being previously served on a regular basis to this audit subcommittee. I'll draw your attention though to paragraph 7 and the identified kind of changes to the risk register over that period. Risk 1.1, insufficient staff to maintain current levels of operational planning, training and management of intelligence. Members will be aware that we commenced a recruitment course which is now concluded, and those individuals, those crew have now moved into a whole time retained crew into will be an ongoing approach now over the next period of years where we will look to recruit into the service in the same way. Risk 2.6 is the potential impact if Merseyside Fire Rescue Authority does not build relationships with the Police Crime Commissioner on prevention, protection and working practices. And again, clearly more appropriate and applicable now than ever, given the fact that the Fire and Rescue Service and Authority potentially moved into and under the Home Office. We continue to have good working relationships with Merseyside Police. It's self-evident. We have the Joint Command Control Centre, and we work very collaboratively with the Police Crime Commissioner, particularly around areas of community safety, and that is evidence within our representation, my representation on the Merseyside Community Safety Partnership, which is chaired by the Police Crime Commissioner herself, and our officers attendance at some of the tactical groups of support, both the Merseyside Community Safety Partnership, but also the local district community safety partnerships. Risk 4.6 is the increased flood risk and risk of extreme weather. And again, it goes without saying that has been particularly challenging, not necessarily for Merseyside, albeit we did have some small areas of flooding around McGull associated with the Bridle, but more pertinent, I suppose, is our deployment of our operational crews to support the events which occurred in Cumbria, Lancashire, and West and North Yorkshire during the recent flooding events, and certainly our deployment was very well received by those receiving fire and rescue services, and the staff who attended the particular instance were absolutely fantastic in regards to the work that they undertook on behalf of the authority, and again recognition of the national role we have in supporting those communities beyond ourselves. And then the final reference point is the wording of risk 4.3 has been changed slightly to reflect some concerns about inequalities and changes societally and with the political landscape, and it's really for us to monitor that the changes, particularly around the impact of the cuts being more broadly than just necessarily associated with the fire service, but the cuts that have been applied to other areas of the public sector and the disproportionate effect on fire and rescue service activities to those within adult social care, say, and so on and so forth. They are having an adverse effect on some of the work that we would undertake, particularly around prevention and vulnerable individuals. So I'll pause there, Chair. Obviously, Appendix A contains the list registered itself. And if there is any pertinent points that members would like to see clarity on, I'm more than happy to answer those questions.
Specific corporate risks. I know you just finished a course for, and we've got two tenders for. But have you got? I understand the decline in the budget and everything else. That, but we're talking about safety here, and the particular issue is not sufficient staff to cover. That would be a great concern of mine. And the other part was in regard to the PCT and the possibility of us having one commander during both services. I would oppose something like that because we need the expertise inside the thing. That is reducing the ability to respond or maintain competent workforce. A lot of the workforce are getting aged. We don't seem to be looking at terms. We're looking at natural wastage to go on, but we're not recruiting behind it. You know, as one goes, we say, okay, that's a saving, where in essence, we've lost the expertise and nobody else is coming in behind it to take up the pit, that approach. The concern of that matter.
Chair, may I pick up both elements of the question posed by Councillor Kearns? In relation to the recruitment, we're probably one of the first fire and rescue services to recruit for a long time, the previous kind of 12 months. I mean, we know that because we had a significant number of people apply from a variety of locations as far reaching as London and Scotland, and clearly, you know, we've run that recruitment process. as we look around the financial challenges, we actually need to reduce the number of firefighters within the organisation to meet what is a challenging budget settlement. But what we also recognise is that over that period we lose a lot of competent professional firefighters, and it's incumbent on us as an authority to ensure that that transition is seamless. And what I mean by that is, we have now committed to, in the short term, but likely in the long term, now we have a kind of a structured financial plan, if that is indeed the authority's decision, to recruit over the next 4 years. Now, what might be massive numbers of firefighters, we're talking in the region of 16 or so firefighters year on year, because when you get beyond 2020, 2021, you probably lose in effect around 110 firefighters over that 2 year period. Now, it'd be very difficult for us to recruit 110 individuals to replace the 110 that have gone in that short period of time. And so, to mitigate that kind of risk to ourselves, we are recruiting now to assure ourselves that come 2020, 2021, we have a competent workforce as well. So, we will have individuals who will have 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1 year's worth of experience rather than 200 people with only months worth of experience. So that has been factored in to part of our succession planning in relation to that, and that's notwithstanding the financial challenges that we face, but just sensible, particularly around firefighter safety and management of organisational risk. In regards then to the kind of same consideration at the chief fire officer level in regards to police crime commissioner, and proposals to have one chief officer looking after both services, that is still, we're still some distance away from that being a reality, and certainly that would have to be the police crime commissioner wants to take on responsibility for fire in the first instance, and again that is subject to ongoing discussions and debate at both the national and and arguably a local level. However, again it comes to the fore that the individual who have that lead responsibility for either or both organisations need to be competent in their ability to discharge those responsibilities effectively across both organisations or single in their own. So that is still for us to kind of consider the most suitable and best option. But it is a consideration for us. It is something that we are mindful of and monitoring, particularly in relation to the kind of the national perspective on this, but also our move from Cllg and under their own office.
Thank you.
I'm pleased that we have a strong succession plan for recruiting new firefighters, and particularly where we are probably one of the only fire services in the country who are actually recruiting whole-time firefighters. And I noticed on social media near enough weekly, our neighbours in Cheshire are looking for recruits, but that is for voluntary retained. So that's something which we've always resisted, and long may that happen, really. But particularly, you mentioned in here about the floods and obviously the fantastic work that ourselves and other neighbouring fire and rescue authorities undertook to go out there with their personnel. And the general public, saying to myself, because obviously they know I'm on the fire authority, what would we do without the fire service? It was fantastic. I mean, and clearly we were very proud to see, on a number of news items, those of our personnel from Merseyside. And it does really, it's something that, we need to keep banging on about, that we have to have our own identity. Yes, we're willing to work in collaboration, and we've been doing that in Merseyside for a long time. But clearly we do need that individual expertise. How could that have ever been better highlighted than the need for us over the local flooding? So, yes, I'm glad we're recruiting 16, and they've now gone through the training. And they, of course, are on different contracts as well, which gives us a little bit more of that flexibility, doesn't it? So, long may that continue if we can, really. So, again, just an observation, really. But I'm glad that we're not recruiting voluntary retained, like some of our neighbours do. That might work for them, but I think we've all said across here that that's not something that we would want to do, and we would want to resist that at every opportunity.
Chair, if I may, I'll just make one response. finance and shares are different, face different challenges and recruit staff in different ways. But I suppose it's self-evident the fact that, you know, if you use Cheshire finance shares are regularly recruiting for returning firefighters, and it's an ongoing, it doesn't kind of stop, it doesn't stop and start, it's an ongoing process that, and that's because of the chain. That's because people come and take on that role, take on for a short period of time, and then get employment elsewhere or move away and so on and so forth, or can't get the necessary commitments to maintaining that retained, you know, or they retained provision, but that retained duty system then is affected by that. And that is something we have, you know, stayed away from at this moment in time, and we have recruited whole-time firefighters, the previous 16 whole-time firefighters, and our intention to do the same again. But there are sort of nuances around the contractual arrangements, and so they will provide four 12-hour day shifts rather than 2 days, two nights, and that's about productivity within the workplace and work environment, and they will provide retained cover during the evening periods. So in effect, we're getting a whole-time firefighter with the skills and ability, but also the same firefighter during the evening period when we are less busy. And that's certainly a fact of the matter. But we still have that resilience available to us should we require for a large or protracted incident. And we believe that's the most effective way to recruit into the service at this moment in time.
Thank you, Phil. No further comments or questions? I think we have to note this report.